you tell me how to get to London from here, please?
You're in London.
I'm in London.
You're in London already.
Here?
Yes. Quite central, actually.
I thought this city was called Westminster.
True.
How do you get there from here?
From here?
Yeah.
You are in London. But in the City of London or London or Greater London itself?
What, this is what? City
of
Westminster, which is a city.
Well, it's classed as a city. Actually, is it?
City of Westminster in London.
So the city's in the city?
I guess so.
So what's the City of London?
I don't know, because I'm actually from Yorkshire.
What about the London called the city?
City of London. Well, that's based around near the Tower of London, kind of way, the old square mile.
But why is that called the city?
Pass.
It's about power. It's about where power is located physically, geographically, and institutionally. It's about a particular power which is located in the City of London, and really what people know and don't know about that power and its relations to other institutions and its historical origins. Lots of people I've spoken to, lots of people in academia, in journalism, in London itself, citizens of London, have heard of the City of London. We hear about it on BBC news reports, in the newspapers. We know of this thing, this square mile, and that it's somehow related to finance and banks and so on. What people know much less about is the fact that there's a political institutional order behind the City of London, called the Corporation of London, that is actually the government of the City of London. And it's the corporation that is a significant node in power relations in the UK and indeed in the world.
Really, the city was hugely important, not just for the development of capitalism, but because Britain was the first capitalist power, and because this gave it an edge over its rivals. The city also spearheaded colonialism, imperialism, the export of capital, the development of productive assets overseas, and presiding over all this were the big merchant banks of the City of London.
London was founded by the Romans. On the south was the military encampment. On the north was the settlement. It was directly chosen to be the easy access to the south, easy access to the north, to the east, to the west. It was very Roman in that way. And it became very quickly the centre of Roman government, but particularly of the maritime economy.
Seesaw, Sacra Dam, this is the way to London town.
Within 40 years, it had been sort of completely wiped out by angry people from Essex, basically, and Norfolk, Boudicca, as she's now known. And then they built the biggest city wall in Europe, a huge one, and with all the centuries facing outwards. So London's always been separated from the rest of the country. To leap forward, it maintained its civic structure. Very strangely, the Anglo-Saxon takeover kind of merged with the Roman. It continued as a port. They developed certain distinctive practices. The hustings, democratic hustings, were invented in the city. That's very important. And at St Paul's Cross, which is where the protesters are now.
Standing in the tradition of Clement Attlee, we demand democratisation of the City of London Corporation.
That's the oldest site that we know of democracy in Britain. They used to ring the bells of the cathedral, and the elders, the aldermen, and the freeborn, the citizens of London, would meet and talk and vote.
The guilds, the livery companies, the ward clubs, the rich networks of association that make up the constitution of the City of London Corporation. These have all basically been taken over by the financial interests, by bankers, insurers, traders, and have been co-opted to promote the interests of financial capital. So the body politic has become a single interest lobby group. That's the story of the last 500 years.
Reform of the corporation's political institutions will mean an end to business block votes in all elections, full democratisation of the city's political institutions, abolition of existing secrecy practices within the city, and total and transparent reform of its institutions in order to end corporate tax fraud.
When the Queen visits the City of London Corporation, she has to wait at the border and be greeted by an alderman before she's allowed to come in. When she has meetings with the City of London Corporation, she can't sit higher than them. So we started to learn these, like, you know, these are kind of little bite-sized things that intrigued us. But then obviously once we looked into the way the City of London Corporation operates, or how untransparent it is and how undemocratic it is, then we started to raise awareness about how, you know, this is an organisation that should be looked at more deeply. So our response to their demand for us to leave was to send them a response. A counter-response, a counter-demand, as it were. And it was very simple. We said that we would like to see your cash register records, your cash records since 2008, your history of lobbying, which remains secret. And we also want you to be open to the Freedom of Information Act.
It was quite interesting. The way they had to move from Paternoster Square to the steps of St Paul's actually provoked a different kind of debate, which in some ways was more difficult and more nuanced than it might have been had they just been sitting outside the stock exchange.
Certainly, because I think that, you know, one of those narratives is that, you know, the idea of the church and its relation to capitalism and relation Absolutely. To modernity, and it's a story that doesn't really get told.
And also because one of the things that's happened with the kind of financialisation of London as a whole city is the privatisation of public space. It was absolutely symbolic of what had been happening in the city, that ordinary people were no longer given ordinary access to Paternoster Square during that whole period. It wasn't just that Occupy was thrown out, but the space then became protected, privatised space. And since a lot of what Occupy was about was the spaces of democracy, that was in itself quite iconic, quite emblematic of the whole thing they were challenging.
So London grew hugely in size, but it grew in size as a population, not as a civic institution. So you had the City of London, which was strictly a square mile, and you had the development of very serious settlements around, most important of which at that time were Westminster, Southwark, Whitechapel to the east, and Holborn or Finsbury to the north. And thus began an attempt, which happened in all other European cities, to extend the city's authority to the new population. Now, very interestingly, the city always refused to extend. So what you had with the William the Conqueror and the recognition, which was verified in a number of charters since, was a recognition of the autonomy of the city. The city was part of the ancient constitution. There was the monarchy, there was parliament, there was the city, and there was the church.
So this is Cheapside, the street connecting St Paul's Cathedral just over there with the Bank of England and the Royal Exchange down that way. It was the historic heart of medieval London, the Oxford Street of its day, where merchants would bring goods from right around the surrounding countryside and even more exotic products they would wheel up from the docks to the street stalls along here. Now those stalls are gone, it's been replaced by a series of trendy coffee chains and expensive clothes shops, many of whom, ironically enough, are dodging tax.
There won't be much of the traditional nativity narrative at the midnight mass sermon in St. Thomas's Hackney. The Reverend William Taylor used to be a City of London councillor. In his sermon, he'll launch a broadside against the city.
It now sees itself as being a lobby group for a single interest, for finance capital, for lobbying for the banks and the city. And it's forgotten its history. And it runs much more today like a company.
The City of London refute this, but today the Vicar has decided to publish a set of private corporation cash accounts on his blog. There's nothing particularly explosive about their content. What's interesting about this, though, is that the St. Paul's camp have another unlikely ally.
I was elected in 2001, first of all, as a councillor for Portsoken Ward in the east end of the City of London. It has two large housing estates and a school, and it's one of the four residential wards of the city. And the reason that I stood was that I discovered that the school was under threat of redevelopment. And this was all happening secretly. No one really knew that this deal was progressing. But I heard through the governors who had been told, or one of them had been told. And I broke the story in the context of a ward election. Save our school. It was a little good little Church of England school. And the families from the two estates, many of whom were Bengali, local East End families, sent their children to the school and they didn't want to lose it. So I was swept to power, as they say, in Portsoken Ward, and took up my seat in Guildhall.
When will you pay me, said the bells of Old Bailey. When I grow rich, said the bells of Shoreditch. When will that be, said the bells of Stepney. I do not know, said the great bells of Bow. And it's Bow, St. Mary Le Bow Church, which is behind us now. Famous not only for its appearance in Oranges and Lemons, but also because it was the bells of Bow Church which called Dick Whittington, the most famous mayor of London in its history, three times to come back to London to make his fortune in the city where the streets were paved with gold. Thomas Gresham was born in 1519, the son of a Lord Mayor. And like Dick Whittington, he wanted to make his fortune in the city where the streets were paved with gold. So he walked from here down to the London docks and got on a boat across the Channel to Antwerp, then the richest city in Europe. And when he was in Antwerp, he saw a new kind of economy, based on credit, based on the imperial plunder of the New World, where young men like himself were beginning to describe themselves as capitalists. And in 1565, he returned to England and created the Royal Exchange, which stood on the site just behind us now. The current building is a replacement which was built after the Great Fire of London. But it isn't an exchange anymore. It's now a shopping centre where wealthy individuals who work in the city can come to spend their money on extravagant luxury products from all around the world.
Essentially what happened in the Tudor period with the establishment of the Royal Exchange is that London took over from Amsterdam, which itself took over from Antwerp, which took over from Genoa, which took over from Venice, which took over from Ostia, which took over from Piraeus as the arbitration centre in the international maritime trade. So London essentially got the Atlantic, set up Wall Street, set up Hong Kong. These were the new maritime centres in the new global economy. And all of the disputes, where there were disputes between in contract, they were settled in the courts in London, in the City of London.
When will you pay me, say the bells of Old Bailey? When I grow rich, say the bells of Shoreditch.
And when will that be, say the bells of Stepney? I do not know, says the great bell.
So, if you're a Beadle, does that mean that you actually live in the city?
I don't. I mean, that was the official title then.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, things have laxed, as they have, including the title. So we don't now carry a cudgel, we carry a mace, which is a ceremonial mace.
Right. If I remember my history, in the Civil War, the city was parliamentarian, not royalist. Is that right?
Parliamentarian.
Yeah? Do you know much about that episode?
No.
The City of London was, as I think it was Edward Hyde, Charles I's advisor, the later Earl of Clarendon, says it was the head and fountain of the rebellion. And all the royalists believed this, and they weren't wrong.
Real big resistance, very strong support for Parliament, attempt to arrest Cromwell in the city was the trigger for the Civil War. Very strong support for Parliament. They won that, and then when Parliament turned a bit restive, they brokered the William and Mary coming down. So by 1688, with the Glorious Revolution, the city is completely secure in its position within the polity. It has all its rights, assets, hereditament in this place in perpetuity forever. It's a very, very big win for the city.
So your family must have a long association with the city.
My dad's been in the city since the late 60s. And he was a Beadle for 40-odd years for Lime Street.
Right.
And I've taken over from him.
This first item here is a county map of Middlesex by John Speed. Originally, this map would have been actually published in 1610, and what we have here is a 1676 edition that was published after John Speed's death. Now, Middlesex, as it used to be, before it was sort of lost when the London boroughs came together, was actually more or less what we would now call modern-day London. And so looking at the map here, we have London clustered very closely around London Bridge, and the cities of London, Westminster and the borough of Southwark were all seen as being distinct places at that time.
I think from the 17th century it conquered a really strategic position in which it was able to be confident of the support of the British state in its activities above all abroad, but of course as at home as well. And you had the establishment of the Bank of England at the end of the 17th century. And that was a sort of nominally a public institution independent of government, but which did impose some constraints, some discipline on the banks. The banks themselves, however, had quite a lot of freedom of action and had developed quite autonomously. Originally, a number of them were, in fact, coffee houses.
For this city is a mart, a bartering place, a rendezvous where thousands trade in the things they seldom see, where deals are made at a casual meeting by the nod of a head or a penciled note, where the nearness of office to market means money in the rush of business life. Here are the exchanges, centres of commerce operated by personal contact, vast, yet as intimate as the old coffee houses from which they grew.
London's obviously a physical place. It exists, it's bricks and mortar, it's roads and all the rest of it. But what happens in those roads, what happens in that bricks and mortar, is to do with imagination, it's to do with how you perceive the city existing.
Unreal city, under the brown fog of a winter dawn, a crowd flowed over London Bridge. So many I had not thought death had undone so many. Sighs, short and infrequent, were exhaled, and each man fixed his eyes before his feet. Flowed up the hill and down King William Street, to where St. Mary Woolnoth kept the hours with a dead sound on the final stroke of nine.
Is it a fortress? Is it held within those walls? Is it open? How do you negotiate the city? How do you navigate those points of the city politically, sexually, any way you like? And that's quite important because different areas of the city have different resonances, and those resonances are very important to the way people actually live their lives. I have to say those resonances change over time, of course. So, obviously, in the 19th century, the Dickensian London, as it were, is quite different from, say, the very rowdy 18th century London, or the even rowdier 17th century London. And, of course, if you went to, say, Temple Bar, you'd see the heads and limbs and bits and pieces of rebels on pikes.
There's the Peasants' Revolt, the Levellers in the 17th century, the whole English Revolution. In the 18th century, there were a lot of riots, particularly the Wilkes riots and the Gordon riots, which, of course, that when they became most serious was when they attacked the Bank of England, and that's when the authorities sort of stepped in to deal with them.
Of course, that will remind you of the political power of the king, it reminds you of the consequences of rebellion.
For those who were simply saying, this is wrong, they shouldn't be here, they're all smelly people and they need to go away, that seemed to, for Christians saying that, that seemed to be a loss of one of the anchors of our faith, it seemed to me.
This is what you referred to as a holy mass.
Yes, indeed. Indeed. I mean, this week, we're Holy Week, we're contemplating Jesus's passion, death and resurrection. And here's a man who was crucified as a revolutionary next to two other revolutionaries.
We think of London as the capital city of the United Kingdom, the metropolis of the British Empire, headquarters of a miniature League of Nations under one flag. We think of her as the city in which the British ideology evolved. A city of splendid buildings in which are treasured the artistic, intellectual and political records of a great democracy and which house the administrations of every important activity. Yet London is not merely a show place nor the monument of a dead civilization, but a vast and vigorous driving wheel in the world machine.
The bankers and businessmen more generally and capitalist interests acquired confidence in the political structure because they could control it, or they had a veto power, they had control of taxation, they had control of the money coming into the government. And this made the British state different from the French state or other absolutist regimes. And it also gave confidence, very importantly, to those prepared to invest in public bonds. And so you got the development of a national debt, which is something that gave steady, reliable income to investors. it was also something that allowed the government in emergencies to raise really huge sums of money, and above all to fight wars. That was the largest item in any 18th century budget, was the military side of things, the navy and the armed forces. Of course, this also involved British businesses developing overseas interests, and a really crucial dimension of this was building up plantations that could supply very coveted items of consumption, like sugar, later coffee, cotton, could supply these to the new internal market that developed as capitalism also developed.
£160,000 of fruit and vegetables a year from Australia, Tasmania, New Zealand, South America, Africa, Europe, Canada, West Indies. London has always been the great fruit centre.
They, to begin with, had indentured servants from Britain, young people who sold themselves for 3 or 5 years to work for a planter. But this source of labour proved quite inadequate as demand expanded. And so they then bought captives on the coast of Africa and used those to staff plantations with what became slaves. And so a great slave system developed, and it provided a huge part of the reason why the British economy in the 18th century developed so rapidly.
Here we have a nice little Georgian plan of London. This particular map was done in 1806 by a guy called Stratford. It's a classic little map of London, really. It really only focuses on what was there at that time.
In 1809, this place looked very different, but there was a young businessman who came here to make his fortune, a young man called Nathan Rothschild. He became very rich during the course of the Napoleonic Wars, and afterwards became even richer by gambling on government bonds and making millions for himself. His family, the Rothschild banking dynasty, became one of the most powerful banks in the world during the 19th century. And the international price of gold is fixed twice a day here in London, which more or less sets the gold price for the entire world. And for 200 years until 2004, that price fixing happened right here in the Rothschild's headquarters in St. Swithin's Court, where five different banks would come together to decide what the price of gold should be.
There's not huge amounts to say about this particular map. It's just a very nice example of an 1843 map of London. Essentially what we're seeing here is just the creeping expansion of London, but we're also seeing the train lines starting to creep into London here. We've got them coming in on every side. The beginning of sort of high-speed travel, or relatively high-speed travel, and people being able to access the city quickly from other parts of the country.
London historically has been quite a varied economy, although it's often had a very important financial sector. There was a very considerable manufacturing sector, and there was a host of really a kind of complex of little industries, printing and publishing, lots of tiny machine industries, all kinds of things which were often subsidiary to other industries. And a lot of those are around what is now the expanding city of London. And then, so another effect of the significance of finance within London at the moment has been that it has bought up land and made land prices impossible for other sectors. And so we've got a huge reduction of the complexity of the economy of the city. Other sectors cannot survive because of the power of the city within the land market. And there's that story of Czechland about the upas tree, you know, the tree under which nothing else can grow. And having a big financial sector is very like that. Nothing else can grow underneath its branches. So it's not a golden goose. It's a tree under which nothing else can grow that actively undermines the possibility of other sectors.
This map predates the Metropolitan Boroughs Reform Bill that came in the 1830s. Much of this area today is sort of largely built up and has been taken in and part of London. But at this time, again, we can still see that the city was fairly small by comparison to its modern standards, and also that we have the clear delineation of the counties. So London at that time was divided amongst its counties, Middlesex, Essex, Surrey and Kent.
In 1889, the London County Council was established. Now, very interestingly, the biggest city in the world only ever had county status. It was ruled as a county, essentially as a rural. County Hall was the centre, because it could not be recognised as a city, but there was only one city of London, and that was the square mile.
Again, here we can see all the railways coming in ever-increasing numbers, and you're just starting to see the sort of bottle-shape appearance of the sort of underground network, which would have just been starting to take form at that time.
London's a migrant city, it always has been. After the Romans, the Saxons, the Jutes, after them, the Normans. Africans arrived here in the 16th century, as did the Romani. Indians were brought here by the East India Company. London's also always been a city of refuge. Huguenots, fleeing oppression in France in the 17th century, settled here. As did East European Jews 2 centuries later, fleeing the pogroms in Eastern Europe. All of these migrants brought with them culture, trades, crafts and ideas that enriched London to become the city people know it as today, a vibrant, multicultural city, diverse in its populations. Yet the city itself has remained a monoculture built around the interests of finance capital and those who are in charge of that economic system.
London has become cosmopolitan at all levels of society. I mean, we are also, you know, we have migrants come to run the health service, we have migrants come in general to help the public sector work. They do the cleaning of the banks in the city. We know all of that. They also come to run many of the banks and the financial institutions in the city, capital C. They also come with their millions to escape from regimes where they may not be quite so comfortable. And they, vast numbers of extremely wealthy billionaires find it very convenient to be in London, and the tax regime allows it to be so. So migration is a subject that covers, and the cosmopolitanism of London covers all strata of society.
Some of the poorest boroughs are on our doorstep. We live side by side with poverty and problems.
So
So I do think that the city does have a social responsibility to go and try and help those boroughs with the talents that we have in the square mile.
What I do have a problem with is the way in which the city treats Tower Hamlets as a bit of a rubbish bin. When the day's over, they can come and have their fun here, get drunk, go to a lap dancing club, and then misbehave on our streets. And that juxtaposition, and that lack of respect for this area of London, which I suspect they would not have for the places in which they live, I find that galling and significant. That I think that does suggest that clear divide. So there is a lot to be done. Overthrow of capitalism is one of them, but in the meantime, it is about ensuring that there is a better understanding of the difference between the world of banking and the world that is just beyond their borders, which is seen as a pleasure zone for them.
It's like the border between Mexico and the United States, the border around the City of London in relation to the East End. Absolutely catastrophic. And the position of the city within London over the last 30 years has been, I think, really, really problematical for the metropolitan area as a whole. I mean, it's massively increased inequality because of the high levels of income, which have put up prices which the poor can't pay, so their relative income goes down. So you have this increasingly unequal city, which is always proclaimed as the most successful city in the country. London and the South East are the richest city and region within the country, but they are also the most unequal.
If you saw my little backyard, what a pretty spot, you'd cry. It's a picture on a sunny summer day, with the turnip tops and cabbages, what people doesn't buy. I makes it on a Sunday look all gay. The neighbours thinks I grows 'em, and you'd fancy you're in Kent. Or at Epsom, if you gaze into the mews. It's a wonder as the landlord doesn't want to raise the rent, because we've got such knobby distant views. Oh, it really is a very pretty garden, and Chingford to the eastward could be seen. With a ladder and some glasses, you could see to Acne Marshes, if it wasn't for the asses in between.
I mean, I have a parishioner who lives just on the estate, just around the corner, who works in the city. She lives with her mum. She couldn't, you know, she's got a good job, but it's certainly not a senior job. She couldn't afford to get a mortgage. She'd like to have her own flat. She doesn't know how to do it. But she doesn't make the connection between what's going on in the city and her own domestic arrangement. She finds it almost impossible to make that connection. I think that's a common story. She, by the way, had never heard of the voting entitlements and the franchise and the City of London ward elections bill.
Remember, it was Labour Party policy from the foundation of the Labour Party that the City of London Corporation would be one of those bastions of undemocratic practice that would eradicate from local government. So it's always been Labour Party policy to abolish City of London Corporation. And I can remember doing speeches in the 1980s saying, when we get into government, this absolute aberration will go. And then during the 1990s, when Blair took over, the policy changed. And the policy changed from abolition to reform, unspecified reform.
I looked at the City of London Corporation to work out what was going on. I mean, I was interested in it, almost as an anthropologist or as a explorer going into some strange and terrifying territory. And I discovered that the City Corporation was at that moment promoting a private bill in Parliament to change the way the vote works.
Then when we came into government in 97, the reform that Blair allowed the City of London Corporation to put through in its ward elections bill was not democratic reform. It was purely and simply extending the votes to more businesses.
So I worked on developing an argument against it with Morris Glassman, and we took a petition to the House of Lords.
They invented a new franchise, a voting franchise, which was based on the size of the workforce. So if you had 5 workers, you got 1 vote, 10 workers, you had 2 votes, and so on. And this was to give the new big financial institutions, Goldman Sachs, Bank of Shanghai, Moscow Bank, a vote in the governance of the city. So it was based on the size of the workforce, but the workforce itself had no vote.
You work in the City of London?
Yes.
You do. What sort of sector do you work in? What's your area of work?
I do IT for an asset management firm.
OK. Is that a UK firm, or is it a...
Yeah, UK.
Firm? And do you know who your firm votes for?
No. I didn't even know they did vote.
You work for a big international bank?
Yes.
Or? Okay.
Japanese.
What, a Japanese bank?
Yes.
I see. In what capacity?
We're PAs.
We're PAs. Okay. And do you know who your bank voted for in the last election?
No.
I work in finance, namely credit derivatives and fixed income.
I see.
Yeah.
And is that a UK-based company? Or?
It is, yes. Yes, it is, yeah.
And can you tell me who your company voted for in the last election?
Who my company voted for in the last election, yeah. In terms of...
The elections for the Corporation of London.
I wouldn't know the answer to that, I'm afraid, no.
Who they voted for? I wasn't aware that they had a vote.
I'm a taxpayer. I live in the city. I work in the city, we're in the city now, the city being that funny little square mile. My local authority is the Corporation of London, and I'm an entrepreneur.
You're not talking about the mayoral elections, are you?
For the aldermen and the common councillors.
Okay, no idea.
No idea.
The city, the square mile, has 25 wards in it, and each ward has an alderman, which were abolished everywhere else in the country 20 years ago, I think.
Do you know when the last election was?
I wouldn't know the answer to that either.
These 25 wards have a number of common councilmen who have, over recent years, been the primary body for acting and taking policy decisions.
The Court of Common Council is the city's own parliament, with powers unequalled in the kingdom.
So you received no information about...
No, they... No, it's not the sort of thing that they would speak to us about, no.
So you've not been asked about who your company should vote for?
Nope.
And so you presumably didn't receive any information about the election itself?
Not that I'm aware of, no. Not that I'm aware of. Certainly not at my level.
Now, if you look at city elections, both for Common Council and for Aldermen, the vast proportion of them are not contested. You know, it's agreed, oh, we'll have Joe in, you know, he's a good bloke, or we'll put Fred up next time and so forth.
Kind of a old boys...
Oh, absolutely, you know, Buggins' turn.
But I don't know where else in the world now where there isn't at least some form of election and democratic accountability for city government. And here we have a group of people who are elected by business rather than a small number of electors. It is literally archaic.
I was approached by some partners in what is one of the top 5 legal firms, Allen & Overy. And so I agreed to stand and was proposed and seconded to be a candidate in the election. I had a sufficiently recognised reputation as a not exactly, you know, docile conformist, the system, the establishment, wanted to make sure that they had their own candidate. So the election took place with these 2 candidates. The unknown me, standing on a clearly specific reform platform, saying that things are wrong, things need to be changed and addressed. I never forget, because the Lord Mayor is the returning officer, and the Lord Mayor had all his regalia on. We were in this room, and it was Matts and Matts and Matts and Matts and other candidate Matt, you know, and I got 79 or 80% of the vote. I mean, shock horrors, they've elected the wrong man. And it really was then all knives out, because the Court of Aldermen, these 25, they had I think it was Edward II or something, a 1252 law, Act of Parliament, which allowed the Court of Aldermen to reject somebody elected by the people if he wasn't a fit and proper person. And I shall never forget dressing up in my morning coat and going into the Court of Aldermen, and, you know, it's very dramatic, you know, all these 25 guys in their red robes and so forth sitting around the head, and questioning me in a sort of, you know, literally, close the doors, lock the doors, everybody else gone, you know, it's highly secret. And again, that, you know, secrecy at the heart of the Corporation of London is I find very offensive. You know, I believe in open government and transparency. Anyway, I was quizzed for a half an hour and so forth, and eventually the Lord Mayor said, you're not a fit and proper person, get out.
The head of a state within a state. For here, he is monarch over all except his king. One of a line unbroken for 700 years. The Lord Mayor of London. Presiding at this, his common council, a parliament older than Westminster.
The building behind me is Mansion House, built in the 18th century as a residence for the Lord Mayor of London. A Lord Mayor unlike any other local official, because he is not elected by the people, but elected by 108 obscure livery companies, from the Worshipful Company of Fishmongers to the more recent edition of the Worshipful Company of Management Consultants.
And then it was headlines in the paper, the Sunday paper, big stories, you know, blackballed aldermen and so forth.
In order to stand as a candidate in the City of London Corporation, in order to be a councillor, you have to be a freeman of the city. It's part of the ancient constitution of the city. And so I got, and to be a freeman, when I stood, you had to get two liverymen, freemen, all councillors or aldermen to propose and second you. So I got two particular individuals that I knew vaguely to do that. At the ceremony, which I became a freeman, and which the clerk to the Chamberlain's Court shakes your hand and says, "I give you joy." That's the invitation or the offering that accompanies the freedom of the city.
And to greet you, my Lord Cunningham, as a citizen and fishmonger of London.
I asked him one or two questions about this relationship between the medieval constitution of the city, representing these ancient guilds and ward clubs and networks of association, and the fact that the City of London Corporation has become a lobbyist for international global capitalism. I said I didn't understand it. Could he explain the relationship of the one to the other?
All this face-to-face interaction and these livery companies are ways in which people get together and in socially acceptable ways engage in insider dealing. I mean, according to the FSA, there's good evidence that about, maybe you want this on camera.
I'm running.
According to the FSA, about one third of all major events, that is takeovers or major announcements of company strategy, seem to be anticipated by the market. You can see that there are share dealings, people buying or selling shares, which reflect the profits that are just about to be announced.
And he was upset by my line of questioning. He felt that it was disrespectful. And then I was invited in to explain my behaviour in the Chamberlain's Court. And then the seconder wrote to the bishop and asked him to investigate my rudeness on this occasion. And he wrote a letter to the Bishop of London, he wrote a letter to me. And he said that, and I quote, "Of the tremendous amount of good which institutions I appear to despise, those associated with the City of London, do for the university I worked at and for churches in the square mile." And he said that my behaviour put such support into jeopardy, which, you know, sounded like a threat. I don't know.
the way we are and the way places are is a product of our interrelations with everywhere else. So England could not be England without having had that empire. And the way in which it is England is a result of all of those relations. The fact that I have the characteristics I have is a result of the geographies within which I am set. And those geographies, those relations within which I am set, are all full of power. And there's different kinds of power. I mean, there's emotional power, there's authoritarianism, there's economic subjugation and domination. So I'm trying to imagine all the webs that tie us all together, both as individuals or as regions or as places or as institutions, like the city. Imagine the relations of power that they engage through with other things and other parts of the world and other peoples.
So we're now standing on King William Street on the 29th of December 1940, the worst night of the Blitz. There were lines of fire hoses going down the street that were 3 foot deep. King William Street Underground Station, which hadn't been used for 40 years, was opened up and became an air raid shelter for 2,000 people. And Britain won the war, but afterwards it was never going to be a great power again. By the late 1950s and the early 1960s, Britain began to discover a role for itself. And part of the story of that is in this very building here, 81 King William Street. It's now the home of the Industrial and Commercial Bank of China, in fact, the largest bank in the world by some measures. But in the 1950s, it was the home of the Moscow Narodny Bank. At the height of the Cold War, the Soviets were very wary about depositing their US dollars in American banks, fearing they would be frozen. Instead, they deposited their US dollars outside of America, here in the city of London. For the first time, dollars were being held in banks outside of American sovereignty. And this was the emergence of a new phenomenon. By 1997, nearly 90% of all international loans were being made through the so-called Euro market. And the advantages of that for banks, for businesses, was that this market was completely unregulated. It existed in the shadows, outside of normal democratic control. It helped banks to avoid tax, it helped them to escape regulations, and arguably, it led to the financial crisis which we saw in 2008.
One of the great lessons of British economic history is the way in which our financial centre, the City of London, has been a global financial institution, as they would call it, serving the world. And they've always seen themselves as a global service institution rather than something which serves Britain, the domestic economy and the domestic people.
Well, the city essentially is the home to finance, it's the home to bankers, it's the home to people who deal with money all day. And in that sense, it's the home to a group of people who control the financial global energy of the world. So it's hardly surprising that people who are annoyed with Parliament, who wish to bring extra parliamentary pressure to bear, who feel that justice has been wronged by the poor distribution of wealth, will go to London, the City of London, to the banks, etc., to protest, rather than go to Parliament.
If you're going to have a demonstration in Britain, this is the place to do it. The heart of the beast, the heart of the monster.
The city cash is one of the three accounts that the city has. It has the city's fund, the public money. It has the city bridge account, the charitable money that hands out about £60 million a year in a good year. And then it has the city's cash, which is its private, which is its private money.
You know, if you've had a pension fund that's been running for nigh on 10 centuries, you know, it's worth a bob or two at the end of it.
We have no idea what the city's assets are, because as an ancient city that's never been in debt, it's never had to declare its assets. So we know that there's three accounts: city cash, the bridge house estate, the city fund. All of them roughly get £250 million worth in interest. But what the principle is, we have no right to know. So we don't know what the city's assets are.
Are we talking tens of millions?
Billions, 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 billions.
Sometimes they say it's £3 billion, sometimes they say it's not. They have never made a declaration of their assets. Extraordinary thing for a public institution, but that's the point. It's a corporation, it's an effective commune, and it's not answerable to external authorities, so it's never had to declare itself.
Some of it goes towards maintaining Epping Forest and Hampstead Heath, but I would say about between 12 and 20 million pounds of it goes towards the lobbying role of the city. So, and I would include in that the money that's spent on the mayoralty, on the Lord Mayor and his foreign visits, the money spent on banqueting and the kind of networks and associations and activities involved with that, and also the money spent on economic development, so paying consultants and think tanks and individuals to produce publications to support the case that the city is trying to make, as well as paying for offices in Brussels and in Beijing.
It's incredible the way in which they have wormed their way into, in a sense, the popular imagination. But I think, as well as recognising that, it's important to recognise that they worked to do it. I've done research on the city, and one of the things that most struck me was the amount of effort they put in to establishing their view of the world as common sense.
In 1966, however, there was a vital departure from all previous Lord Mayor shows. The procession was a window on the city's economic activities, emphasis being laid on the vast contribution to national economy made by the banking organisations, international insurance, investments and commodity markets, contributions which have many times rescued Britain from financial crises.
So, for instance, there was, during the 80s onwards, a huge amount of research, reports, documentation, interventions into debate everywhere to establish that the city, the finance sector in particular, was the golden goose of the economy.
It's the only organisation that has an officer of the corporation actually sitting in the Commons Chamber. The city remembrancer has the right to sit in the Commons Chamber.
What is deeply disturbing in terms of our democracy is the fact that the city has a representative sitting on the very floor of the House of Commons. He's called the Remembrancer, and he dates back many centuries to a long ago historical accident. But the really important thing is that he's there on the floor of the House of Commons, so he's able to, as debate goes on, wander around and whisper in MPs' ears. And probably even more importantly, is he's able to see every piece of legislation that comes out as it's being drafted. He can comment on it and influence it.
And indeed, if you look at the statute books, it's interestingly down the centuries, because every piece of Parliament, every piece of legislation that came before Parliament, there was a city standing on the side saying, oh, hang on, we want to have a look at that and see how it impacts us. Almost every piece of legislation on the statute books since Magna Carta probably mentions the Corporation of London, because it says, with the exception of the Corporation of London, or with respect to the Corporation of London, special provisions, you know.
And when you think about the fact that the Mayor, Lord Mayor of London, says that his role is to represent and promote the financial industries, then you can start to see what an incredibly pernicious and unbalancing effect that can have on Britain. Because manufacturing industries don't have a representative wandering around whispering in MPs' ears on the floor in that way. Our nurses don't have that. Our retired people don't have that. And if you look at the way the whole British economy has become horribly imbalanced in favour of the financial industries in recent years, then you can start to see one of the mechanisms by which that's happened.
Mm-hmm. It's like a state within a state. It has immense lobbying power over the British government, but it sees its interest as essentially global. It sees its rationale as global, and by the way, it sees its profits as global profits. Now, that's okay, in a sense, if this global approach and the British economy are in tandem, but they're not.
It's reinvented itself as a place which is, I think, the most important centre for international currency dealings in the world. If you go down the list of commodity trading, it's massive in the ways, in the proportions of commodity trading that happen in the City of London. In a host of ways.
The City of London is really a hub for the most important tax havens. I mean, probably over half of all of the really large tax havens, maybe as much as three quarters, are actually British. I mean, you know, the Channel Islands, the British Virgin Islands, there are tons of these tax havens, offshore financial centres, they're sometimes called.
There's a direct funnel between money coming into the city and money going down to the tax havens. So they're all linked together. The basic proposition being that financial services are more competitive if the lower taxes you levy upon them. And in order for London to remain, and its tax havens around the world, to remain competitive, they need to have a low-tax environment.
They play an important role in the growth of an unregulated dimension to the whole banking system that is actually larger in terms of the assets involved than the formal banking system itself. It's sometimes called the shadow banking system, and the shadow banks are really institutions which are sponsored by onshore banks in the City of London or in Manhattan, but they maintain relations with the Cayman Islands or Bahamas.
It was one of the inventors of that. We think of globalisation as somehow being just global, but actually it's invented, you know, everything is invented in particular places. And neoliberalism and globalisation were quite significantly invented in London.
We're down by between 3% and 4.5% generally across these markets. We're down over 16%. Dow at the same time has fallen about 18%. The stock market is now down 21%.
Because we're now down 43%.
What started in America last year has now spread to every part of the world.
We're down 9% today. The Zetra DAX over in Frankfurt is down by 9%. The Paris market down by 9%. Austria, which was briefly suspended earlier on in the day, is down by nearly 11%.
If you think what's happened over the last three decades in this country, we're now facing an economic crisis as a result of finance capital, not just its mistakes, but its ability to exploit our economy, building up huge debts, making massive profits, and as a result of that brought about a crisis in our economy. Mm. Those policies that enabled the city to do that started in the 1980s when Thatcher was in power, because of the city's influence on Thatcher, and the Big Bang during the 1980s, which completely deregulated the city, as well as introducing new technology to enable it to speculate even faster and further. That built up through the period of New Labour as well, where most of our economic policy was based upon allowing the city to be deregulated and get its way, make vast profits, you know, Mandelson comfortable with the filthy rich, and most of them were in the City of London Corporation. That exerted the power to enable them to speculate and profiteer.
You don't have to go very far in Hackney to see the way that the global financial network affects the life chances of the people who live in this area. I mean, our economy is geared towards the service industry, and the kind of jobs available for young people coming out of school at the moment are very limited, mm. and you know, not very skilled. They're pretty low grade jobs because our economy is dominated by the financial services, and obviously that generates a degree of superficial prosperity and a desire for stuff. You know, people want stuff. They want the right brands of clothes. They want the right kinds of hardware, computers, telephones, what have you. So it is a kind of religion. You know, the City of London Corporation promotes a kind of religion around commodification, and it makes it very hard for people because they get into debt in trying to achieve these illusory goods. It makes it very hard for them to find the time and the energy and the resources to work on, spend time with their families, work on local community issues, care about their neighbours, develop, you know, those kind of community relations that I believe, as a vicar, promote health and happiness.
I mean, I think capitalism has taken on a new form in the last 20, 30 years. The whole international sense, global sense of capitalism is not either what was being proposed by Adam Smith nor that was being opposed by Karl Marx. It is a new phenomenon. And I think that we have not yet found proper ways of expressing our opposition to that. That those of us who were opposed to capitalism in the past, those of us who were then committed to a thoroughgoing socialism, have not yet found the language and the forms of organisation that properly address this global capitalism. And in many ways, we see attempting to hold on to the older forms of resistance no longer work. And I think that's why Occupy was a very good thing. Because it began to suggest that there are other routes to go on in order to begin that organisation. And it may look really messy now. It may not get us very far. But if it's laying the foundations of a really new approach to opposing the form of capitalism that we now find, then great, that's a good start.
I mean, London is without doubt a global city or a world city. I think a lot hangs on what you mean by that. Mostly, it means that London is a crucial node in the global economy. It's one of those places with power and at the intersection of, you know, major power relations within globalised economy. But London's also a global city or a world city because of its multicultural population. It's a world city in certain senses in the arts. And I think sometimes thinking of London as a global city, particularly in relation to finance, obscures the rest of London. So if we think of it as only a global city, we forget about all the other things that go on in it. We just become the add-ons, you know, the academics or the baristas or the just ordinary workers, the people who drive buses. I'm not sure to what extent we're part of this thing called the global city. So there's a way in which the part, you know, is substituting for the whole. And that means that we get hidden from view, the rest of us. And I suppose it would be nice to have a view of London, and a real London, that was more complex and more multifaceted and less dominated by finance. so that we could take more seriously the interests of all those people who are the rest of London.
Say.